بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله تعالى نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Continue from our lessons of the tafsir or the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have reached the 20th set of verses to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because this class of tafsir, we're going through it in orders of revelation. So we reached the 20th set of verses to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Surah 2, which was Surah Al-Abasa. Jayid? And we're still in the Makkan stage, because we're still in the stage before the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Although we looked at the Hijrah of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, when we looked at the Hijrah of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we looked at Surah Al-Abasa, sahih? So we're going to quickly revise bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, and then continue with the class, and hopefully cover the muqaddimah, the introduction to the Hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abasa wa tawalla. He frowned and he turned away. And the person that is being referred to in this ayah is who? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now as we all know, wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is kalamullah, is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam directly with the intermediary of who? Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam. So even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam directly to Jibreel, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still spoke to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a third person form, saying, Abasa wa tawalla. He turned, or he frowned and he turned away, rather than accusatively, which it would be, Abasta wa tawallayta. You frowned and you turned away. And we said the reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a third party form was what? Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayah is telling off, or a gentle telling off from Allah ta'ala to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because the telling off is gentle, if he said abasta wa tawallayta, this is harsher and more severe. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used a third person form saying abasa wa tawalla. And you find this many times in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in telling off or correcting the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used a third party way of telling off the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And if it's direct, it's usually preceded by something. For example, the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in telling off the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, Lima adhinta lahum, why did you allow them? But it was preceded by what? Afallahu ank. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has pardoned you. To put the mind of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at rest. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Lima adhinta lahum. Because the way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam takes the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not the way we take the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Lima adhinta lahum, it would have been heavy upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abasta wa tawallayta, you turned away, or you frowned and you turned away, it would have been heavy upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because when it comes to the anbiya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to them, they see khilaful awla, leaving off that which is okay or that which is better and doing something which is also good to be a sin. If you remember, Allah Ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَرَفَعْنَا عَنْكَ وِزْرَكَ. We've lifted your burden from you. Meaning we've lifted your sins from you. And we said the sins of the Anbiya, according to one explanation, is what? Khilaful awla. That they have two choices in front of them, two good things they could do. And they choose one of them, but the other one was better. They see this as a what? As a sin. So if this is the way of the Anbiya, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, abasta wa tawallayta, that would have been heavy upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's why they say, that hasanatul abrar sayyatul muqarrabin. The good deeds or the righteous ones is the bad deeds of those who are close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Abasa wa tawalla. And this is right to who? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he frowned and he turned away. And ja'ahu al-a'ma. And this is the reason the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam frowned and he turned away. And ja'ahu al-a'ma. That a blind man or the blind man, he came to him. And the sabab al-nuzul, as we mentioned previously, of this ayah, was Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktum came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And at that time, there was an individual or individuals from the aristocrats of Quraysh, who the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted them to become Muslim. Because by them becoming Muslim, their subjects will accept the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was busy speaking to them, hoping for them to enter the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And ja'ahu al-a'ma. And then Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktum came while the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was speaking to them to ask the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said it was a question or about ayah, a verse in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At that point, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he frowned. So this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he revealed the ayah. That the Prophet ﷺ frowned and he turned. Jayid, and ja'ahu al-a'ma. So we know the person is who? Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktum. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not mention his name in this surah. Just like many sahaba, the ayahs were revealed concerning them, but their name specifically is not mentioned. For example, the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَسَيْجَنَّبُهَا الْأَتْقَى الَّذِي يُؤْتِ مَالَهُ يَتَزَكَى. That you avoid the hellfire. The one who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one who gives out his wealth. Who's this ayah concerning? Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Jayid? Oh, the saying of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّتِي تُجَادِلُكَ فِي زَوْجِهَا وَتَشْتَكِ إِلَى اللَّهِ. The sahabiyya, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed this verse because of, we know her name, but Allah ta'ala did not mention her name. Rarely would you find the names mentioned in the Quran. The difference here, however, is though, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not mention the name, Allah will give a general description or pronoun, male or female. But in this ayah, Allah ta'ala said, Al-A'ma. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described him with a description of normally deficiency. Al-A'ma, the blind one. And we know in Islam, we refer to people by their names, but not by their disability or deficiency or that blind man. No, if we know their names. But the ulama, they say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said al-a'ma here for two reasons. In defense of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and in defense of who? Abdullah ibn Ummu Maktum. How is this in defense of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. You have the greatest of characters. But some will say, how could he frown in the face of this man? But the man that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam frowned, did he see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He never saw the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Never. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ala khuluqin azim. So even though he frowned, he did not see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And once a person came to see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Medina. And before he arrived, this person was a munafiq. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hated him. The believers hated him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hates him. When he arrived, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he smiled in his face. And Aisha radiallahu anha, she was surprised. How could you smile in his face? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from his akhlaq and adab, he never frowned in the face of anybody at all. So firstly, in defense of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Secondly, in defense of who? Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktum. How is this in defense of him? Because normally when people are speaking, engaged in something important, you don't cut them off. But he didn't see. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qaddama lahu udhur. Allah ta'ala put forth an excuse for him saying, an ja'ahu al-a'ma. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wama yudrika la'allahu yatzakka. And what will make you know that through you answering his question or his inquiry, it may become what? Purified. Aw yadhakkaru fatanfa'ahu aw tanfa'uhu dhikra. There's two recitations, fatanfa'ahu aw tanfa'uhu. And due to tanfa'ahu, they have two different meanings. That may be yadhakkaru, he may remember. And the remembrance may what? It may benefit him. The ulama, they say this ayah is a tazkiyah, is a reference from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktum, that is a believer in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How is this a tazkiyah that is a believer in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah ta'ala said maybe the remembrance of what? Benefit him. Allah Ta'ala said another ayah, وَذَكِّرْ فَإِنَّ الذِّكْرَى تَنْفَعُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ And remind, or remember, or reminder for verily remembrance, it benefits the believer. أَوْ يَذَّكَّرُ what's the eye again? فَتَنْفَعُهُ الذِّكْرَ And the reminder may benefit him. So this is a witness or shahada for Abdullah ibn Maktoum that he's a believer in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَمَّا مَنِ اسْتَغْنَى As for the one who sees himself as being what? Self-sufficient. And this issue of self-sufficiency is attached to wealth and status. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was speaking to the aristocrats of the Quraysh, or one of them who had wealth and they had status. To show wealth and status is not always a what? A ni'mah. It could be a niqmah. It could be the opposite of a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَلَمَّا نَسُوا مَا ذُكِّرُوا بِهِ When they forgot that which they were reminded of, فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ We gave them everything. حَتَّى فَرِحُوا بِمَا أُوتُوا When they became happy with that which was given, أَخَذْنَاهُمْ بَغْتَى We seized them all of a sudden. So wealth is not always a blessing. Because if a person has wealth and he's not humble, he sees himself as being what? Self-sufficient. Not needing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which is why the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before he sends a messenger or he sends a prophet to the people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا We've never sent to any nation إِلَّا أَخَذْنَا أَهْلَهَا بِالْبَأْسَاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ Except prior to the coming of the messenger or the prophet, the people are seized with adversity and suffering. Why? لَعَلَّهُمْ يَضَّرَّعُونَ In order for them to become humble. In order for them to become humble. So this wealth and this status is not always a blessing. And it could be a cause of misfortune, not only for those who are arrogant and pride, but also for their people. Because the reason the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was eager in accepting Islam is that if they accept Islam, their people accept Islam. So these wealthy ones, these people of status, these people of position in society, they're not only a cause of misfortune upon themselves, they don't fall deen of Allah Azza wa Jalla, upon their people also. And that's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, أَلَمْ تَرَ إِلَى الَّذِينَ بَدَّلُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ كُفْرًا وَأَحَلُّوا قَوْمَهُمْ دَارَ الْبَوَارِ جَهَنَّمْ Do you not see those who exchange the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Or they give in exchange for the ni'mah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kufran, disbelief and ungratefulness. And what they do? They have placed themselves وَقَوْمَهُمْ and their people دار البوار the most evil and wretched of places, Jahannam. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لو أسلم عشرة وآمنت عشرة من رهبان اليهود لآمنت اليهود. If only 10 of the priests of the Jews are to become Muslims or believe, the rest of the Jews will believe. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, as for the one who sees himself as self-sufficient, فَأَنْتَ لَهُ تَصَدَّى You give him all your face, you give him all your attention. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا عَلَيْكَ أَلَّا يَزَكَّى وَمَا عَلَيْكَ أَلَّا يَزَكَّى What does it mean? The letter in Arabic, ma, has two meanings, or more than two meanings. It could mean, for example, ma, like I was asking about Mutillah yesterday at work, ma hadatha, ma hadatha. Hadathi means happened, yes, in the past. So if I say ma hadatha, what does that mean? Yes, what happened? Or it didn't happen, barakallahu fi. Because ma could mean a negation or an interrogation. So the ayah, وَمَا عَلَيْكَ جَزَاكَ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا وَمَا عَلَيْكَ أَلَّا يَزَكَّى It could either mean, وَمَا عَلَيْكَ It's not upon you. That if he decides not to purify himself. وَمَا عَلَيْكَ What is it upon you if he doesn't decide to purify himself? So this ayah, it has two meanings. وَمَا عَلَيْكَ أَلَّا يَزَكَّى وَأَمَّا مَنْ جَاءَكَ يَسْعَى As for the one who came to you striving, the ulama, they said it's another shahada for Abdullah ibn Maktoum, that was a mujahid. Because he came striving, and was mentioned that he took part in the wars with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the second shahada for him. Wahuwa yakhsha. And he comes having khashya, fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They said this is a third testimony for Abdullah ibn Maktoum, that he's a scholar. How does this make him a scholar? وَهُوَ يَخْشَى Because Allah Ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ عُلَمَى The people that fear Allah from His servants are what? The ulama. And there's a difference between khawf and khashya. Khawf is the normal fear. But khashiyah is fear with knowledge. So Allah Ta'ala said that Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktum wa huwa yakhsha, and he came fearing. And with due to this tazkiyah from Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, for Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktum, when we look at the sabab al-nuzul as we did last time, it is mentioned that after this ayah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kana yukrimuhu, he used to honor him and elevate him. That Abdullah ibn Maktum, if the Prophet is in a gathering, he will never stand up to greet anybody in a gathering. It's not from the Sunnah of the Prophet. He will never stand up to greet anybody. The only person or people who stand up to greet is somebody coming from a journey. Or Fatima radiallahu anha, and also Abdullah ibn Maktum. Only these three. Individuals, only these two. And he will stand up and he'll say, Ahlan wa marhaban. Welcome to the one atabani rabbi fihi, that my Lord told me off because of. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every time he went for ghazawat, he will leave Abdullah ibn Maktum as the Amir of Medina. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came to Ramadan, the official mu'addin of Ramadan was Abdullah ibn Maktum. The rest of the year, Bilal radiallahu anhu. But for Ramadan, Abdullah ibn Maktum. That he used to say to the people, إذا أذنت Bilal in Ramadan, if Bilal makes the adhan, كلوا واشربوا, continue to eat and drink. حتى يؤذن Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum. Until Abdullah ibn Ummi Maktum is the official one. Even though he was what? Even though he was blind. He was the official mu'addin for Ramadan. That at the time, when it's time now to stop eating, the people will be saying, Asbaht, Asbaht. It's morning. He will not make the adhan. Asbaht, Asbaht. Until so many people tell him, then he'll make the adhan. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he honored him with this. And that's why they say, based on this ayah from the lessons, is that a person, when he tells somebody off correctly, with gentleness, the one that's telling off, it only increases him in love for the one he's telling off. Because the basis of telling off is based on love. It's based on love. As a parent, as a husband, as a friend, as a brother, if you're sincere in telling somebody off, it's only because you love them. And this is very important for the children to understand as well, and for young people. Nobody tells you off except they love you. Because some things you do, it doesn't affect them. If your parents don't care about you, if your brother doesn't care about you, if your friend doesn't care about you, they'll not tell you off. But a sincere person will rather you hate him for doing the right thing than you love him for doing the wrong things. So when a person tells somebody off, the one that's doing the telling off, increases in love for that person. And the person that's being told off, if it's done correctly, it also increases him in love for the one that told him off. This is an important lesson, that ad-deenu nasiha, as we said in Surah Al-Asr, ad-deenu nasiha wa tawasaw bil haqqi wa tawasaw bis sabr. Another lesson we learn from this is that when I ask a brother, wa ma alayka alla yazakka, it's not upon you. Or what makes you think, you know, it's going to become purified? When it came to Abdullah ibn Maktum, when it came to tazkiyah, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say? Wa ma yudrika la'allahu yazakka. Just by you answering this question, maybe it will become what? Purified. Look at the difference between the mushrik and Abdullah ibn Maktum. That he will become purified. As for those, wama alayka, it's not upon you. Meaning he'll not become purified. So Abdullah ibn Umm Maktum was blind physically, but he had more insight and was better than these people. So the belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always better than the best and the best and the best of the kuffar. The best of them. And this is a principle we need to hold. That in this dunya, in the same way the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had dignitaries, aristocrats, or the people of Quraysh, if a brother, a Muslim, no matter what his status is in society, comes to you for a need, and you're busy with other people, and you can answer his need, is of more priority. You should honor him more. Cleaner, road sweeper, toilet cleaner, he deserves more honor and respect than the best of the kuffar. Which unfortunately people don't practice today. They see these people, they honor them and respect them than the Muslim. Which is ajeeb. Inna sharra dawab inda Allah. The worst of the creation, the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who disbelieve in Allah azza wa. The worst. Asfala safilin. Asfala safilin. So the believer, lesson the surah, that the believer, yazakka, he purifies, is better. Another lesson from this surah is that he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asking a question that may help him. Therefore, the asker, as we did in Surah 2, Ad-Duha, anybody who comes asking you for something, wa amma sa'ila fala tanha. Do not dismiss the asker by shouting or using words or gestures which are rude and inappropriate. And this happens many a time. People come begging. Sometimes people mock. Like, for example, I remember Sheikh Uthman Khamis, Hafizallahu Ta'ala, he said, once they were in a car and some children came begging. You know, some parts where we have children just begging surround the car. And the children were saying, Atini, 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 Atini. He said, one of the people in the car opened his window and he said to the children, Atini, Atini, give me, give me. And the Sheikh said, don't do that. Wa amma sa'ila fala, don't mock them. Wa amma sa'ila fala tanhar. Don't do that. So what about the one who shouts at them, get lost, you're fake. If you cannot give, just keep quiet. If you doubt, because I don't really encourage when people come and beg in the masjid or asking outside the masjid, I don't encourage this. But if you cannot give, do not be rude to them. This is one type of asking. The second type of asking is su'al al-mas'ala. Somebody comes to you asking a question. So there's asking in terms of material and there's asking in terms of question. That you have to be patient. Some people say when Abdullah ibn Maktoum, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, making an excuse for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that when he came to ask him, if he could not see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how would he know where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was? How would he know? Come here, Luqman. Come. Yes. Yeah, come. Is there more than one meaning of come? Why? I'll tell you in Yoruba. Kale. I'll tell you in Somali too. Yes, ta'al in Arabic. So come. Yeah. So if a person is blind and he's looking for Luqman, Luqman is not coming up here. How do I look for him? If you've ever walked with a blind person before?
Yeah.
You understand? And ja'awul a'ma. So a person, you're in the middle of something very important and he's coming. Like this. It doesn't matter how he comes. You can sit down now. Jazakallah khair. In the manner as he comes, you have to be patient. And an example for us is David alayhi salam. Not you, David. David alayhi salam. Dawood alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَهَلْ أَتَاكَ نَبَأُ الْخَصْمِ إِذْ تَسَوَّرُ الْمِحْرَابِ. Has it come to you, the story or the incident of al-khasm, those people were in a dispute, إِذْ تَسَوَّرُ الْمِحْرَابِ. When they climbed over the fence and went into the mihrab of Dawood. The mihrab is not this thing that's called, it's a secret place, you isolate yourself to worship Allah Azza wa Jal. So they climbed over the fence just to ask a question and they entered upon him in his most secret place of his own. فَفَزِعَ مِنْهُمْ. He became shocked and he was scared from them. They said, لَا تَخَفْ. Don't fear. The first thing you have to say is what? I'm sorry. So, لَا تَخَفْ. خَصْمَان بَغَى بَعْضُونَ عَلَى بَعْضٍ. We're two people in a dispute. No apologies, no sorry. We climbed over, you walk into the most secret place of your own. But Dawood alayhi salam, because they came asking a question. He was very patient. And then they asked him to judge. فَحْكُمْ بَيْنَنَا بِالْحَقِّ. Judge within us, between us, in truth. Subhanallah. You're talking to a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you think he's going to judge بِالْبَاطِلِ? So judge between us, in truth. وَلَا تُشْتِتْ. And do not exceed. And even when you listen to إِذَاءَةُ الْقُرْآنِ, be in Qatar, be in Saudiya, you listen to the questioners. How they question the Shaykh. بِاللَّهِ عَلَيْكَ يَا Shaykh. By Allah. By Allah, Shaykh. Be sincere and be honest. Tell me the right answers to this question. Subhanallah. Be sidq. In truth, tell me. But the sheikh, he has to be patient. You understand? When you go to the mahkama, I've been to the courts here. I've been to the courts in Kenya. How people talk to the judges, subhanallah, malik al-quddus. Especially when it comes to issue marital affairs. Yes? Of men and women. Even if the man is the oppressor, and you know the woman goes for khula', seeking a divorce and that, the way they will speak to them, subhanallah. Like the judge say, you know what, I've listened to this case. You say, you know what, judge, you marry, I don't want to take her. Like that. Just like that. I have seen things, even in this Ramadan, in my local masjid, the imam, he makes what they consider to be a mistake. The way they speak to him, subhanallah, malik al-quddus. But he's patient. I get angry for him. And I've got my younger brother with much of a temper, Luqman. He gets more angry for him. But the imam is patient. So therefore, when we ask a question, we learn from this incident with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فَلَا تَنْهَارُ. Because if he really wanted to rebuke him and correct him, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have then what? Not frowned or turned away. He would have said something. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he never said anything to him. Important lessons for somebody who comes to ask. How long has it been? Today, we wanted to cover the introduction to the Hijra of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But next week, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, we'll begin with introduction. The incident in Darul Nadwa. Darun Nadwa was a place, a conference center for the Quraysh, that any important affair, the Quraysh would discuss it there. And the purpose of this conference in Darun Nadwa is that the Quraysh, they realized the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, lahu shi'a, he has people or support from other than them. And the affair of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has spread. They can't do anything. So decided to convene or bring about a conference, a gathering, to deal with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they came up with a number of solutions. And the person that attended this nadwa in person himself was who? Iblis, Shaitan. So based on this Darun Nadwa, it was the precursor or the cause or the catalyst for the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So next week, inshallah ta'ala, we'll cover this, the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, inshallah. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.